I'd like to thank everyone for coming. My name is Elaine Studnicki, and I work with the Historical Society. Actually, Bill Venny is supposed to be here, our president. I'm happy to report that he's with his family for happy things and events. I asked Bill, I said, Bill, do you have any anecdotes about maybe Jim Canfield or some things that happened in the city when it was just growing up? And he looked at me, he smiled, and he said, no. But I wish he was here. He was actually on the first council as well. So we're just thrilled to have our three mayors here, as well as Art Dyke. And I know that there are members of this audience that have been here since the beginning and could tell us wonderful stories as well. I am simply here to start the introductions and to give a few announcements. Do you know that the Historical Society has had many homes, and we have settled down into Holland Park, and we're thrilled to be there. But, you know, yes, we have, you know, we have the museums being worked on, our research centers being worked on, and we're just waiting until Holland Park is opened. To have a grand celebration where we all can be together again and share stories more intimately and have other people there as well. So just know that it's been a long year for us not being able to reach out to you more than we would have, but it's almost done, and we know it's going to be a fabulous park, and we're happy to be there. Another note is that we have our annual meeting in January, so please plan to attend. Patricia Eldridge is going to wave there. We are certainly looking for volunteers. Now, I know that you're saying, oh, I volunteered before and maybe I don't want to do that. But when I think about the class of people that we have to speak today and all come together and make this city what we want it to be. And together we can do that. Not letting other people do all the work, but chipping in a little bit. And that will make our historical society and our city a much powerful and happier place for everyone. So please consider volunteering. I also understand that on November 3rd in City Hall, our We Honor Your Honor celebration will occur. So Mayor Jon Netts will be celebrated that night and day, so please make arrangements to be there as well. So he's telling me 4 p.m. Thanks, John. All right. So I was thinking about this introduction that I have to make here, and it is really an honor to do this, because when I think of Art Dyke and Jim Canfield and Jon Netts and Melissa as well, I think about what they're doing, and what they're doing is, and for the most part, is giving up the best years of their retirement to serve us, to make sure that we have a healthy and happy environment to live in, and to make sure that we have an historical perspective about how all of this happened. That's a lot. That's a lot to just say, to do that without any need or want of recognition. So it is a real honor, and I can't tell you how happy I am to work with a man that has such distinguished characteristics and not a selfish bone in his body. And so with that, and of course, historically speaking, he's top shelf too. I'd like to introduce Art Dyke.
Brochure that you see here was a total creation of Elaine Studnicki here. She represents the future of our society, and you can see exactly why. So thank you so much, and She's heading up, spearheading, along with Patricia Eldridge, she's spearheading that we get a new society. Some of us are getting old, some of us, okay? And we can really need some rejuvenation at this particular point, and we've got the talent to do it. So please consider and spread the word that some of you might want to work with us in the society itself. I hate to start with an apology, but I apologize a little bit for last year we had a crowd that was out the door. People could not come in. And so we thought maybe we would be easier on them and have a reservation system. And that was a bad mistake. That was too onerous because you had to make a call in and get an answer. Also, as far as our advertising was concerned, followed by the name of Matthew, got in the way a little bit, and so there was not word out as much as there should have. So, for maybe not keeping that, or maybe for Matthew, all right. I'm sorry that we're not jam packed today, but welcome all, and thank you for being here. I am going to be looking at a few notes here. And last year, when we did the Founders Day, we did it with the ITT beginning. Founders Day was originally conceived by the City Council in 2006, and it was Founders Day for the ITT Corporation founders. And that date is the October 29th in 1970. So that's our official Founders Day for ITT Palm Coast. But of course, we are a product of the city of Palm Coast. We are the City of Palm Coast Historical Society. And Founders Day for the City of Palm Coast would be, I guess, December 31st, 1999. We can't do the Founders Day for the 29th because usually it conflicts with Halloween, and we can't get a space to do it at that time, so we do that at another time, and we're doing this one at another time because too many of you are off doing something else on December 31st of the year. So so we will pick, we will do the two subjects, but we will pick a different time to be able to do them. I do start every program, my slideshow and all, and I have to start the program really with a recognition of my brilliant and beautiful wife, who is right here in the front. And the book that we did was dedicated to Louise, and it was also dedicated to Jim Holland. And I just want to read you the dedication that we gave for Jim Holland. He said, "Jim Holland, as a representative of talented civic volunteers and government leaders who selflessly contribute enormous amounts of time and energy for the enrichment and benefit of the communities in which they serve." And that stands for the three mayors that we have sitting before us at this particular time. When you're thinking of it, okay, these mayors really get the big bucks, don't they? Huh? So, well, we every one of you are in that category, and we thank you. We are most, most grateful to you all for all the time and the energy and the goodwill that you give to our communities. Mayor, we are a very historic place here. This was our first city hall. And I'm quite sure Mayor Jim will be talking about the 2.5 rooms or so that that we had here. And also, in this room, as a first city council spot, basic decisions were made. One of them was that we were going to be an environmentally great place. And right in the beginning, folks wanted to build up everything, and one of the first actions taken when the city council sat down and said, hold it, we're going to sit back for about 90 days and figure things out. And as a result, now we have a beautiful linear park whereby just from outside the door, you keep on walking down and seeing the beauty of Palm Coast as we know it. The other place that, of course, is a historic place is where our historical society is going to be. It has a long history that goes back to being a plantation many years ago, and thereafter named after James Holland, who was a city council person and a true leader in the community. And so now we're located well historically, and we're going to be glad to be getting into our new place. Yep. Okay. Well, I would like to introduce again, Mayor Jim Canfield. Mayor Jim.
Thank you a lot. Thank you all for coming. I remember this room well because we had all the city council meetings here. When we first started talking about a city, I had met with Jim Holland many times in the kitchen over there. I had to pay $5 for each meeting we had because they charged fees at the time for a person who wasn't elected using those rooms. And also looking at this wall here, when we first started with our city council meeting here in this room, I got an email from somebody. An email says, the city council looks like you're all in a jail because all I see is this white wall behind all the meetings. So we immediately talked to the city manager, and we had all of those nice wood panels put in so that we wouldn't get the same kind of complaint every time when we're looking at TV. So that's just a little bit of a side for some of the early days of our city council. First, on the incorporation effort. One of the things I wanted to talk about at the incorporation effort was that we vote without political parties. We're nonpartisan. And a person running for office cannot put ads in a paper saying they're Democrat or Republican because it's a nonpartisan election. However, in the beginning, when we first started talking about Palm Coast becoming a city, there were political parties involved. At the time, the county political group, mostly the Republicans at the time, they were in favor of Flagler County becoming what is called a charter county. Now, a charter county is a county that runs the same as the city. They were following that idea because in 1986, only 20 years or so before we're talking about starting here, Jacksonville, with Duval County voted to become a charter city with all the powers of a city. And what happened was that the whole place became the city of Jacksonville, except for a couple of small beach towns which stayed out of that that time when they consolidated for that county. And the Republicans at the time here wanted Pike to become a county such as that, a charter county. The difference in a charter county and a regular county, as Flagler is today, is that the constitutional one difference, the constitutional officers, their pay is determined by the state. The state comes out every year and says what these constitutional officers can be paid. Whereas a charter county like Jacksonville is, then the elected officials determine what the pay is for all those constitutional officers, and they eliminate some of the elections involved with the constitutional officers. So that was the thing that we were faced with. Jim Holland was a very influential person in the Republican Party at the time. And that's one of the reasons we would talk. I was the chairman of the Flagler County Democratic Party at the time. And so that's one of the reasons we would start from that point, whether the effort was going to become a charter county for Flagler or whether the effort was to become Palm Coast become a city. And let the county do what they wanted to do in the future. So we had a lot of discussions about that. And the first thing we had to do was to get a group of Republicans and a group of Democrats who would agree that let's move forward and try to make Palm Coast a city and not to get involved with the county effort to become a charter city. So that's one of the main differences in the background of the thing. And when we became a city, we declared it nonpartisan, so politics wasn't involved in that. Also, I wanted to mention today that this format today, the agenda today, in 2020, with 2020, Palm Coast as a community is be 50 years old. Now, that's not that far away. So the Palm Coast Historical Society is going to publish a book at that time, the title of which will be Palm Coast 50 Years. And Art is going to be the author of that book. He spends all his time doing that and researching the city and doing what the city history is. And then the years that we're talking about as mayors here will be appropriately at that time in the book. So what we're doing today really is starting to put that book together, and what you hear today will be a lot, will be that included in that book that's coming out in 2020. We expect the city will have a big celebration for 50 years. Let's hope we're still around here to see the book published and have it distributed. For my tenure as the mayor, it's an easy assignment for me because at the end of every year, I wrote down what I thought was our accomplishments and what our trials were during that year. And at the time, there was a newspaper called the Flagler Times. And the Flagler Times would give me the pleasure of publishing it. I would give them I thought it was for the year, and they would publish the year summary in their newspaper every January, first week in January. Now, the Flagler Times has gone out of existence, I guess replaced by the Palm Coast Observer. And I don't really remember when the Flagler Times went out of existence, but It's a good service for me because I have documented those first 7 years, and what I'm going to talk today is just a few items from the things that the Flagler Times published as the year-end summary. Our first city council meeting was held on December 16, 1999, and this was the council to get prepared for our officially becoming a city. Judge Kim Hammond swore us in, and his advice to us after he swore us all in, just remember to follow the law. That's all he said to us as a new city council, remember to follow the law. And then at this first meeting, Sheriff McCarthy, who was sheriff at the time, came to talk to the council, and he said, you have to pass an ordinance for New Year's Eve. And the reason he wanted us to pass that ordinance for New Year's Eve was what was on our law at the time for the county was that all the bars and clubs closed at midnight on New Year's Eve. In order for us to keep the bars and the clubs open till 2 a.m. New Year's Eve, we passed an ordinance that night, and then Sheriff McCarthy said he could go around and not close them up until after 2 o'clock. That was our first city ordinance. I think we passed 58 ordinances in that first year. That was number one. A lot of people ask me, why did we become a city on December 31st, 1999? Instead of waiting to become a Millennium City January 1st, the next day. The reason was that if we became a city on December 31st, there was over $1 million in tax-shared revenue that the state legislature was going to give us because it was based on that year, 1999. The next day, we would have got nothing from that. So there were some feelings about, well, it's better to become Millennium City. Others would say, you know, let's take the money and go as a city as of December 31st. That's why we did it. And that's why the official city start was on December 31st. Now, on that, we had the city halls, and we operated out of this room for the time, and then we operated out of the old library, and then we went to the building, the industrial building, for a while. So we jumped around for a sit. But our first city council was comprised of Bill Venny. Now, each council member shares in all the discussions on everything that's passed. But each council member, based on their backgrounds, based on their personal interests, seemed to focus on some particular area of city government that they have a vital interest in. And I'll tell you what theirs was. The first member, Bill Venny. Bill Venny concerned himself with street lighting. He was always complaining we didn't have the lights in the city. The city was dark at night, and we needed more city lights. And that was his focus, that and public safety. And those were the two items that Bill Venny concentrated on. Jim Holland was an expert in municipal finance and budgeting. And that was his focus. And we relied on Jim for that. Jerry Full was an environmentalist, a tree hugger. And he was concerned with the environment and keeping Palm Coast a beautiful place. Ralph Carter was interested in public housing. That was his background. He came from public housing in New York City. And he was also concerned about civility in council discussions. And whenever two members started to argue a little bit about an item that they both had a different interest in, Ralph Carter would remember civility and calm things down. Myself, as the mayor, I concentrated on economic development and public recreation facilities. So those were the things that we were all concentrating on and during our initial discussion. The thing that came up in the first year was the three items, the buffer zone, apartment complex, and a moratorium. The buffer zone was Jerry Full's idea, and he had worked on it before becoming a council member. He urged that there be a 50-foot buffer zone where nobody could build on both sides of the Palm Coast Parkway and to limit any development to that. The builders and developers at the time, they wanted only a 20-foot zone. So that was a discussion of that in the first council to protect Palm Coast Parkway, which was our main street. So the council passed a 35-foot buffer zone for both sides of Palm Coast, and that has helped us keep Palm Coast beautiful and keep it with the green, as much green as possible on the main thoroughfare. The apartment complex is located at the corner of Beltair and Pine Lakes Parkway. And that was a development for 216 units, which at the time was our biggest housing development coming in. The people who lived across the street in one-family homes, they argued against that. They thought that a big apartment house across the street would cut down on the value of their homes. And other people argued against it, saying the traffic on that intersection would be overwhelming. It passed by a 2-3 vote, or a 3-2 vote, which was the first time in the first year that we had a vote on any subject that required passage by a 3-2 vote. So it was controversial, but it was passed. Then we had a moratorium. What happened was, in our first year, the developers were all coming in with plans to build big developments because there was a housing boom on. And here we were with five council members, plus the city manager, and the five council members, the developers come with their blueprints and all their plans and their land plans and all of the things that were involved with building. So we realized that very quickly that we didn't have the expertise to evaluate those plans and to evaluate them in such a way with an expertise in land development and some of all the other things that go into a building, a housing complex, or any type of development. We didn't have the expertise to evaluate these plans, whether they were worthwhile or not for the city. So I led in the council and asked for a six-month moratorium on all construction in the city until the council had a chance to put together a group that could handle that type of construction and take a good look at it. So what we did was we then created a planning board, we created a code enforcement board, and the other hired planning experts during that year, and that was necessary in order for us to have qualified people in place in order to pass those early developments. And we were being hit with one a week, and we really didn't have the background. At that meeting held here, every pickup truck and every large working truck that was available, all of the Chamber of Commerce was out in force against us. The Committee of 100, we had a Committee of 100, they were out in force against us. And as I said, every pickup truck was out there, and they had to move trucks all over the place outside, saying we were going to ruin our city economy, and we're going to get people unemployed, and we were going to. So we passed the moratorium, and in spite of all the objections all these people had, which was probably one of the best things we did, because that provided us with the proper zoning and the proper developmental rules to keep Palm Coast a good place to live. Our first budget, first 9 months, we operated in conjunction with the county because we didn't have an official budget. We were waiting for money to come in. So the county cooperated with us on providing our services for the first 9 months of that year. And then we had our first budget from October 1st, the year 2000, to September 30th, the year 2001, as a new city. I just want to give you some of the numbers on that first budget. The property tax rate was 3.15 mils, which had been promised to the people in the feasibility study we had before we became a city. The property tax income was $4.7 million. The state revenue sharing came $4.8 million. The general fund provided a total of $9.5 million to operate the city. And we also got, at the time, there was $3.3 million that came to us, again, with a cooperation from the county on a deferred garbage tax revenue that was somehow coming to the city. The expenditures for that first year was the fire department, $1.7 million, and the developmental services, $1.8 million, public works, $2.2 million, and law enforcement, $750,000 to the sheriff. And the expenditures were $9.5 million to match the income. Now, one of those things in our first year, and there again, the county was very cooperative with the city. When we started our own fire department, some of the county workers were working for the fire department. They had to decide whether they come work for the city or they wanted to stay, keep their job working for the county. Public works people, many of them had to decide whether they wanted to come over and work for the city or stay with the county with the jobs of taking care of the roads and things like that. Law enforcement, we budgeted $750,000 for, at that time, for the sheriff, and that was supposed to be a temporary type of thing, so that eventually we were going to have our own police department. When we decided to become a city, we should have our own police department and not rely on a sheriff. The $750,000 to the sheriff was to help provide law and safety for the city of Palm Coast. Since that time, I think we still pay the sheriff department so much a year to provide city. Soon, I think we will be 100,000 people in Palm, city of Palm Coast. That will probably happen within, John, and you could tell us more than that about when we'll reach 100,000. I think within about 4 or 5 years at least. Now, almost every city in existence that has 100,000 people has its own city police force. So that's going to be a question that the city council has to respond to. Do we continue paying the sheriff, or do we create our own? We create our own fire department, our own public works department, and all of the other things that most cities have. One of the things that I've mentioned, that we had good cooperation with the county during our first year. Over the budget, they donated this building to the city. They donated the public library that we had to the city. They were good working together. And so there were issues, though, that came up after we worked together for a while. And I would say that one of the problems that we had was initially, and I talked about creating our own fire department, creating paying for some of our police efforts and stuff like that. The theory was on that, and the theory when we were out there electioneering to become a city, the theory of that was that if we create our own fire department, we're taking 80% of the county's work away from them because we're paying for our own fire department. And if we give $750,000 to the sheriff, we're subsidizing his effort to provide law protection for us. And what happened was that we assumed that it'd be a tax trade-off, whereas we're pulling in all this work that the county had before, that would mean that the county taxes would go down. And so the Palm Coast people wouldn't keep paying the same taxes for the county when we've relieved them of 30% of their expenses. And the county never reduced their taxes. So that started a little bit of animosity between the city and the county. And it would calm down from time to time, and then it would flare up again about some things. But they were very helpful in the beginning, and I always say during my tenure as a mayor, at the end, we were developing pretty good relations with the county. Now, we talked to them about some dispute about whether the airport is in the city, should be a city airport, and not a county airport when it's within the city. County won that argument. And then they're talking about 50 acres that is in Palm Coast next to the city, and that should be part of the city somewhere along them. And what happened was that at the end, Jim Darby was the chairman of the county commission, and I was the mayor at the time. And I started working pretty well with Jim Darby on some of the things that we were both interested in. And one of the things that we accomplished together was the creation of the Palm Harbor Golf Course. That was the county involved in that. The way the county was involved in that was that Hunter's Ridge is a housing development that the county was building. And part of the arrangement for building Hunter's Ridge community was that the developer was going to build a golf course there. And so the county was going to enforce that. The Hunter's Ridge Golf Course would have been partly owned by the city and partly owned by the county, and it would have been developed. Somehow that didn't happen. Hunter's Ridge developer promised to do it, but there was no time in the contract on when he had to do it. That could have been forever. But about that time, we had Darby, myself, and a few other people had a committee, a joint committee, and we kept working on it. And eventually, when a developer was leaving here, and he gave the Palm Harbor Golf Course to the city to operate, and whether it operates as an enterprise fund or it operates with some tax money involved, will be a dispute for a lot of the future. So that's one of the things that's concerned, that we did work together, and we can work together when the time comes. Another thing where the city and the county didn't get along was our purchase of the water company. As soon as we became a city, we started sending letters to the water company asking if they were interested in selling the water company to the city. Initially, they wrote us back saying they had no interest, and if we moved in that direction, they were going to take us to court. Eventually, we were able to purchase the water company. The county opposed that. The county, when ITT left, they offered the water company to the county. The county refused to take it. And so then what happened was that when we became a city, we wanted the water company. We want the water company because it's a key to economic development. And when people come in here thinking about building places, they want to know if there's adequate water, a sewage system, and what do you pay for it? And the idea was we could buy the water company and provide water as cheaply as possible. So that's another area where we didn't get along with the county, and I think if I read the papers right, they had a little argument about the water, who's supplying water to certain areas of the county in the last few months. So I've used up all my time. But as I said, all of the things we did, I think for me, people working together, if you get good people working together on a city council, and if you get good people working together with the same goal in sight, good things happen. And that's Also, I think I would like to mention, we've had two excellent city managers. The first city manager we hired was Dick Kelton. And Dick Kelton was, when we hired him, he was the finance director for Volusia County. He was making $130,000 a year. We only authorized ourselves to pay $90,000. And Dick Kelton took the job. He took the job because he was interested in starting up a new city. That was an opportunity that most city managers get very rarely. So he took the job and he helped it. And I think with his foresight and his knowledge was one of the things that we developed very well in our early years. And then when he retired, 2006, at the end of 2006, then we hired Jim Landon. And there were 100 applications when Jim Landon was interviewed for the job. 100 applications. We had 101 applications for Dick Kelton, 100 applications for Jim Landon. And they were picked out of a large group. And they were both excellent. I think that the success of the city relies on the good people we've had in the city council and the good people we've had directing us as a city manager. The city manager council form of government has worked well for us. And I think one of the reasons we are a good city and we have a good future is because of that. But one of the people who worked with me during all these years, the first 6 years, was Jon Netts. So many of the things I'm talking about, Jon can take credit for also, because he was part of the council that involved that. And he's got more experience. Now, I was limited to term limits. I could only serve 8 years and then go goodbye, which I did, which was fine with me. And I think term limits is a good idea. Jon was limited to term limits also, but he got an extra year because they changed the voting date. I don't know how he arranged that, but he got that extra year in there. So he's probably going to have the record for the longest 9 years as mayor than anybody will ever have, because they won't change the city charter to limit you to 8 years. But they looked around that, they gave Jon a ninth year. And he might, he'll probably still be active and take some sort of elected position in the near future. But it's my pleasure to introduce Jon Netts, valuable member of the city council, valuable mayor, and a very good friend, Jon.
Thank you very much. Jim was talking about each council member having their own particular focus. He nicknamed me the pothole councilman. My focus was on roads, roads, and roads. When we became a city, there had not been adequate maintenance of our roads. They were deteriorating rapidly. And I'd come into city council meeting just about every time with a photograph, a photograph, a photograph. And he finally called me the pothole councilman. But we did take care of it. Let's see. We are what we are because of the vision of that first city council. They point you in a direction. There's two sayings that I love. One, if you don't know where you're going, any road will get you there. We knew where we were going. And the other one, of course, is even if you know where you're going, if you don't keep moving, you're going to get run over. And what we've done from those first days to present is keep moving forward. That was the early days. Some of you may remember that. That was your vote of incorporation. Jim talked about the library. That upper right-hand picture, that was the old library. That was our second or third city hall. We've had a bunch of them. There was your city council, Jerry Fole, Jim Holland, Halsey Mormon, Mary DiStefano, Bill Lewis, Jim Canfield, of course, mayor, Ralph Carter, Bill Venning, Frank Meeker, Alan Peterson, Dave Ferguson, all part of what's making this city what it is today. And then we've got your current city council. Mayor, at least for another 15 days or so, Bob Cuff, newly elected, Heidi Shipley, Jason DiLorenzo, and Steve Nobile. That's your current city council. from the very beginning, from the very outset, the vision was to become a premier city in which to live, work, and play. In those years, a lot has been accomplished. Let's take a look. Whether we like it or not, ITT created Palm Coast with a swale system for stormwater management. Environmentally, it's wonderful because it allows water to percolate back into the aquifer, it allows recharge, it allows the water to be treated before it's discharged into the intracoastal. But the downside of the swale system, very, very difficult to maintain. We made a policy, 25 miles of swale to be rehabilitated every year. Now, if you figure we've got 550 miles of road in Palm Coast, swales on each side, that's a lot of swales. 50 miles of road resurfaced. That, I think, was one of the accomplishments that this city council can be proud of. The pothole councilman lobbied for this. We need to do something. The county at the time was doing 2 or 3 miles of road a year, and the roads were just deteriorating. One of the problems of a community like Palm Coast, they're what they call a pre-platted community. Typically, a city starts with a little nucleus, and it grows, and it grows, and it grows, and it grows. And as it grows, you add new infrastructure. Well, for a variety of reasons, the state, the federal government, the county government insisted that when ITT be built, you put all the infrastructure in at once. You put all the roads in at once. They all deteriorate at the same rate, whether or not anybody living there or not. We went before the voters, and we asked for a half-cent sales tax for 10 years. And I can remember, I'm sure Jim can remember, me standing there and saying, I pledge over my dead body will we spend one penny of that money for anything other than roads. At the time, the city manager said, oh, it'll never pass. It's not a good idea. This is not a good time to be asking for money. Well, guess what? We went out to the voters. The voters approved it. And by golly, we did 50 miles of road each and every year. One of the most difficult things in city government is to keep your infrastructure in pace with growth. As you grow, you have to increase your infrastructure. If you don't, you're going to have people miserable, unhappy. It's not going to be a good place to live. So look at some of the things that we've done. You all lived through the widening of Belterre Parkway, four-laning of Belterre Parkway. ITT had a very interesting concept. They knew that this city that they were creating was going to grow. They did something that most other pre-platted cities did not do. They set aside land. So if you see a road that has the name Parkway in it, Palm Coast Parkway, Palm Harbor Parkway, Belterre Parkway, they may have created a two-lane road to begin with, but they set aside land so that you could expand it. Go look at the city of Deltona. Similar concept, similar kind of construction. It was built by a large corporation. No set aside for land. You can't expand the roads there. We've been able to do that. The sixth laning of Palm Coast Parkway. The addition of the interchange at Matanzas Woods. If you remember those fires in the late 90s, you couldn't get out of Palm Coast. Now we've got a third way out onto 95. The interchange there, the overpass at Matanzas, the extension of Palm Harbor Parkway to bypass the high school, to get traffic away from the high school. These are things that are very, very important for your infrastructure. We started off with a fire station in Palm Coast. Whether we like it or not, we can describe ourselves as suburban or urban. And we knew that the level of service that the county was willing to provide was not appropriate for a community like ours. I'll tell you a little story. Many years ago, I served on the city council in New Jersey. And I can remember somebody coming up to me and says, hey, you're the fire commissioner. What's our fire budget? We were a small community and volunteer fire department. I said, it's about $500,000 a year. He said, what was your fire loss last year? And I said, about $35,000. See how stupid you are? you should shut down your fire department, self-insure, and you could save $470,000 a year. And I looked at him. I said, you know, the reason the fire loss is so low, because we put them out quickly. We put them out quickly. And let me ask you another question. Well, that community was a lot of 2- and 3-story buildings. I said, suppose it's your mom, suppose it's your wife, suppose it's your daughter on the third floor trapped by the flames. How much money would I have to put in the budget to compensate you? What we realized is that fire service depends on proximity. Not necessarily miles, but response time. You talk to the fire chief is right there. If you can catch the chicken while it's on fire in the oven and restrict it to that, you've lost the chicken. But according to the fire service, fire doubles in volume every 3 minutes. You wait 6 minutes, you wait 9 minutes, now the kitchen is in flames. You wait a couple more minutes, the whole house is engulfed. So we've been able to add 4 fire stations, something we're very proud of. Wastewater treatment, or water treatment plants. The mayor talked about buying the utility. Actually, there was an intermediate step. When ITT left, they offered the utility to the county. The county said, no thanks. So Florida Water Services, a conglomerate, bought it, operated it for a number of years, realized that it wasn't what they wanted to do. They put it up for sale again. Again, the county had an option to buy it, chose not to. There is an organization known as FGUA, the Florida Government Utility Authority. They were going to buy it. They operate utilities on behalf of local governments. We were all comfortable with that until two little cities up in the panhandle, the cities of Milton and Gulf Breeze, put in a higher offer. Milton has a population of about 6,000. Gulf Breeze has a population of about 12,000. Now, why do you suppose two little tiny cities way up there in the panhandle would want to buy this utility? Money. Because as a government, they would not be regulated by the Public Utility Corporation. So at the last minute, we jumped in and said, to protect our residents from what we know is going to be a disaster, we'll buy it ourselves. And we did. We had a water treatment plant. We built a second water treatment plant. We built a third water treatment plant. Why? Growth. We had an original wastewater plant, or more commonly known as a sewer plant. One of the trickiest things in government is to pace your infrastructure with growth. You heard the expression, build it and they will come. I don't like that. Suppose you build it and they don't come. You still have to pay for it. As of about a year ago, our wastewater plant down Utility Drive was operating at about 94% of capacity. Well, what's wrong with that? Not a thing. Providing you put the big sign up, say, no more houses, no more businesses, no more growth. I don't care that you own a vacant lot in Palm Coast. You can't build on it because we're at capacity. But you don't want to build that sewer plant too quickly either because you don't want it sitting idle. But right now we're under construction for a second wastewater treatment plant, keeping pace with growth. Holland Park, our first park, our only park for a long time. But over the years, we've added additional recreational facilities. Ralph Carter Park, the tennis facility, the golf course. That's part of what makes people want to live in Palm Coast. If you have nothing to do, stay where you are. Recreational expansion, very, very important to it. I wish I could tell you that Holland Park was done. It's not, although there is light at the end of that tunnel. And next year, 2017, this facility is going to be totally rehabbed. So we are preparing for future. Come on. When ITT created Palm Coast, the word sidewalk was not in their vocabulary. They didn't put any in. And if you look at the road structure in Palm Coast, all these interesting curves and cul-de-sacs and curlicues, they built this community for the automobile. realize that not everybody wants to drive everywhere. So we started off early on under Mayor Canfield's leadership, starting adding sidewalks where you could. And we realized very quickly there has to be a pattern to this, because what good is a piece of sidewalk here and a piece of sidewalk here? First priority was put the sidewalks on the paths that lead to the schools, because we know that the kids aren't going to drive to school, and mom and dad probably don't want to drive them to school. So we started putting sidewalks in along the paths to schools. And then we said, second priority, let's start connecting pieces together. They've been a very, very, very significant part. Mayor-elect Holland will tell you a story, and if she doesn't, I'm not going to steal your thunder, but she's going to tell you a story about bike paths and trails. Employment. We keep hearing about the unemployment rate in Palm Coast. We are, whether you like to admit it or not, somewhat of a bedroom community. People live here, and they go to Volusia County, they go to St. John's County, they go to Jacksonville, they go elsewhere to work. When our unemployment numbers went up, it's not that they lost jobs here in Palm Coast, it's jobs they lost elsewhere. But for some reason, the government tracks unemployment by where you live, not by where you work. But the reality is, in the last 5 years, there are 11,000 people more employed in Palm Coast than there were 5 years ago. That's significant. Construction. Yeah, we had that building boom that Jim talked about, and then we had that massive recession, but we're coming back up again. Each, for the past 4 years, the number of building permits has increased each year. Tourism. We've worked very closely with the county and the Tourist Development Commission to try to encourage tournaments, sports activity, recreation, tourism. Right before the hurricane, right after the hurricane, we had the pumpkin shootout. 40 teams came into Palm Coast, lacrosse teams. Now think about that. The kid comes in to play lacrosse. Mom and dad came with him, maybe brother and sister. Our hotels, our motels were filled. They ate in our restaurants, they shopped in our stores. That's part of the economy growth that we want to see. City Council, during that recession, said, you know, we need to get our priorities straight. The first and foremost thing is to maintain our neighborhoods. There's a phrase in New Jersey called blight flight. If a neighborhood starts to deteriorate, pretty soon the surrounding stores start to deteriorate, and you go from a boutique to, a tattoo parlor, and from a tattoo parlor to a... There's that kind of deterioration. And it works both ways. If your commercial starts to deteriorate, pretty soon the surrounding homes start to deteriorate. You're probably aware of the fact that during the growth period, four huge developments of regional impact were created in Palm Coast, west of US 1. And I can remember City Council saying at the time, you're not going to destroy our old neighborhoods. Our first priority is going to preserve our existing neighborhoods. One of the reasons that we were desirous of purchasing the Palm Harbor Golf Course, to protect that neighborhood. City services, beautification, housing programs, these are the kind of things that make your community worthwhile. Business assistance. Several years ago, we created the Business Assistance Center. Only City of Palm Coast partnered with the University of Central Florida to bring in their professional staff, supplemented by our staff. If you're an entrepreneur and you want to start a business, come to us. We'll help you do your business plan. We'll help you lay it out. We'll help you get it started. If you're a business that wants to grow, come see us. We'll help you, point you in the right direction, provide expertise. If you're a business that's struggling, come to see us. We'll help you. Something no other place in the state of Florida is doing. And in fact, investment. We want people to invest in our community. Not just homes. In fact, Mayor Canfield, I'm going to get it wrong. But Jim used to say, for every dollar that you collect in residential taxes, you provide $1.37 worth of services. For every dollar you collect from retail, commercial, and industrial, you provide about 60 cents worth of services. A good community has a balance, not just residents, but residents and non-residential. We're working toward that. Something that started out as a good idea. We had City Hall here, 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 here. We had fire department here, 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 here. We had public works here. We had the utility department here. And we were paying a heck of a lot of money to interconnect these various stations through the telephone, through wires, and so on and so forth. We said, you know, rather than us paying all this money to somebody else, suppose we put in our own fiber optic network. Suppose we start connecting our facilities one to another. Good idea, save some money. We found out very quickly that fiber optics has almost unlimited capacity. Not like a piece of copper wire that you only put so much data over. Fiber, you can, it's, so we went, wait a minute, why don't we take this backbone of fiber optic network that we've created and make it available to local internet providers? So we have partnered up with local companies. We'll provide the fiber optic backbone. You go in, hook it up to the building. You charge your customer for the service. You pay us for the use of our backbone. That's where we're headed, folks. You hear this talk all the time about we want high-tech business. You got to have high-tech facilities if you want to attract high-tech business. Fiber optics. How many city halls do we have, Mayor? Here, there, there, here. I think you left a couple out, the back room. I think there are six different buildings that we wound up in, or were in. We wound up over in City Marketplace paying $250,000 a year in rent. Guess what you got to show for yourself at the end of the year? $250,000 worth of rent receipts. We had struggled once before with the idea of building a city hall. Perhaps we were overly ambitious, but it was turned down by the voters. Actually, what they turned down was a bond issue. We wanted to borrow $40 million to build a city hall and build some community centers, and they turned it down. I think probably rightly so. So we said, let's approach this from a different perspective. Let's not use any residential tax dollars. Let's not use any general operating fund dollars. Let's see if we can build a more modest city hall on land that we already own, using community redevelopment dollars, using money left in the building department dollars. We built a city hall. Not 1 cent of your tax dollars went into that. Saving $250,000 a year in rent. And for the first time really in the history of our city, we have a professional place for our professional staff to work. And consistent with the original concept that Palm Coast was going to be an environmentally friendly place, LEED certified silver. I think there are five such buildings in government in the state of Florida. That means it's an environmentally friendly building. If you haven't seen it, come on down and take a look. The only city in the state that has hazardous waste pickup at your doorstep. Now, if you want, you can take your motor oil, you can take your car batteries, you can take your paint cans. There is a hazardous waste dump down Old Kings Road operated by the county. Good job. Not everybody wants to drive with that stuff in their car. Call our Waste Pro provider. Once a month, we'll pick it up at your front door. Only city in the state to offer that. Part of being an environmental leader. Well, that's where we are today. Now we're going to find out where we're going tomorrow. It is my pleasure to introduce to you Melissa Holland. Her daddy was the one that convinced me to run for city council in the first place. It's all her fault.
Wow. Well, what's that phrase? We've come a long way. We certainly have, haven't we? When you think of Palm Coast, it's interesting because I have a lot of memories in this building. I've sat through many city council meetings from the inception and the incorporation of the city. I have sat through many city council meetings following it and watched each and every city council along the way make deliberate decisions on where we sit today. And that deliberation is very, very important when you think about it. You've heard about our history. You've heard about ITT and what its intent was. And you also understand every single person in this room came here for a particular reason. Each one of us came here because it's a beautiful community to live in, right? I mean, nobody is objecting to the fact that our community is not one that they set out and set forth to relocate here. So we can all agree upon that, but what we do with it is really important moving forward. The leaders of this community for years set out with the intent to demonstrate what ITT led down with the foundation, but to move us forward in a very progressive, professional manner, and they've done so. But it took a lot of work for them to get there. I'm going to talk a little bit about where I see us going in the future, and certainly what my intent is going to be as your next mayor of Palm Coast. But let me talk a little bit about the relationship and the dynamic that's going on in our community right now. We do have some issues that we're going to hopefully work through in regards to the county commission. There is a divide that has taken place in the last few years as far as communication. We have an upgrade issue that we need to really address, and that's the 800 megahertz system. Just so you understand, the 800 megahertz system is a communication device where our first responders, in a case of an emergency, case of evacuation, case of something that's very serious going on to the community, have the ability to communicate with each other in order to keep our residents safe. We've been told by the county recently that that system, by 2017, certainly will be out of service. They feel that they can still utilize some of the parts that they have to maintain that system until it's paid off until 2020. The problem with that being is, as stated before from both mayors, is the city has a practice. The city sets aside money and pays for services that we deem necessary for our residents. So we have to sit down as a community between city and county and understand what those needs look like, what the cost of that upgrade of the system, because I'm telling you it's going to be very substantial. It's not an inexpensive item to purchase, but it's a necessary item to purchase. When you think about our first responders and the evacuation process that it took just recently with Hurricane Matthew, that didn't happen overnight. There are a lot of things that go into that. There's a lot of different operations and practice moments that go through with our fire chief, our sheriff's department, and in order to communicate adequately to our residents during those moments of concern and crisis, you have to have the adequate equipment. So it's my hope that very quickly and early on in my term that we're able to reach a set of guidelines to understand what those needs are going to look like so the city can then start putting money aside annually to pay for that when it comes to the upgrade. And that goes hand in hand when you think about communication and coordination with dead zones in our community, right? No one likes to think about those dead zones, but Grand Haven is a good example. Grand Haven is without cell service oftentimes. And as well as our school districts, our schools within our community are dead zones. So it's my goal and my hope and my strategy that when we do upgrade these systems and we do form a close working relationship with the county, that we're then able to take that moment and say, okay, how do we then integrate a system that's going to make sure and ensure that we have full capability of service throughout our community? We are a population today of 82,000 people in Palm Coast. When I came here in 1987, there were 10,000 people in the entire county. It's changed dramatically. Our population has changed. And so that's going to be a very critical issue moving forward. So I hope that we are able to accomplish that. It is important to work together and collaboratively. But let me talk a little bit about what my intent and how our community is so special and unique to me. I came in here in 1987, and my father retired from AT&T and quickly immersed himself in local government. So these stories that I've heard today, I've heard year after year from my dad, and I was very fortunate to do so. Someone asked me the other day, why are you so interested in local government? I think, and I've mentioned that, unfortunately, I think I was genetically predisposed by Jim Holland, because I had no other choice but to sit down around our dinner table and understand the dynamic in our community, what that looked like. So he very quickly immersed himself in local government. He found a way to serve on the Solid Waste Committee, the Economic Development Commission, and it was an interest of him when the city incorporated what that would look like, what the foundation would look like, how it would be fiscally responsible in that challenge, right? Because you're creating a whole new city. So I want to applaud our forefathers for not only the hard work that they put into this, but this was a challenge. It's not an easy feat when you're looking at creating a new city. One, quite frankly, that has a tremendous amount of infrastructure already laid into it, and some of that infrastructure was aging. So the intent was good. The voters decided. First city councils thereafter have all set forth with a path and course that was deliberate. So I'm going to ask you, what do you love most about Palm Coast? Is it the stunning canopy that greets you along eastbound route on Palm Coast Parkway? It is for me. Is it the friendly greeting you often receive at local shops? The smiles and waves you get from neighbors or people who pass you on the street? Or is it the biking trails? I'm going to talk about the biking trails for a moment. I had the great privilege while I served on the county commission for serving on a regional transportation committee that was going to loop 260 miles through 5 counties of biking trails. So oftentimes I was asked to speak at different trail conferences. And I remember sitting there with different speakers that came before me. One of them was Pat Northey, who used to serve on the Volusia County Commission. And she was bragging about all these amazing biking trails Volusia County had in its path. It was amazing, 64 miles of biking trails. And I'm sitting there like a child, cannot wait to get up and brag about Palm Coast and Flagler County, because we had over 100 miles of connectivity of biking trails. That's extraordinary. I mean, think about that for a minute. Not only are those paths utilized by cyclists and runners and our moms pushing their strollers and their children, it's a great way for us to connect as a community. Oftentimes, when I'm walking my dog, Marley, I get to connect with residents along the trail, get to hear about their stories, what brought them here. So it's very, very special and unique. I love our biking trails, and I hope to continue to expand on those and continue to connect with those paths along the way. We have birding, fishing, tennis, golf, boating. All of those amenities, when you think about it, are the reasons essentially that our residents relocated here. They wanted those amenities. ITT had a very intent years ago to make sure that we had golf courses and tennis facilities and a marina and a swimming pool and those amenities that were offered to our residents. And I will stand here before you today and tell you that my intent and my commitment to the residents of Palm Coast are continue strengthening those amenities, offering those amenities for our residents as not only a way to continue what we've already had, but to attract more and more residents as we move forward. Those like-minded residents that attracted all of you here are the residents that are going to be here for our amenities that we produce. So each one of our elements, as you heard earlier, is quite unique. Each brings a mind of peace, a sense of peace. We're not Volusia County, and there's nothing negative against Volusia County, but we're just not. When you get off Palm Coast Parkway, you see a whole line of trees and a lot of greenery and shrubbery, and it's just beautiful. It's a very different feeling that you get there when you get off of 992, and you see a lot of those signs and everything else. Those were deliberate decisions. Those were policy decisions that councils before us made to, in order to continue enhance our community and continue increase our property values and maintain what we've put in place. So our history is not really too distant, if you think about it. Mayor Canfield spoke of 50 years. 1999 was when we incorporated. We're not really an old city. Past 9 years, challenges have certainly come our way, as Mayor Netts has described. We went from the fastest growing city, second in the nation, to the number one unemployment rate. I will tell you that the city council has done an extraordinary job throughout those times. You don't see a lot of blight in our community. You don't see a lot of neighborhoods that are just becoming run down. That's because they made those decisions in order to maintain our infrastructure. We do have some future projects that are going to be coming up in the future. It is going to double, potentially, our growth, if you think about it. Now, this is an interesting dynamic. I remember when I was in the county commission traveling to Tallahassee with Mayor Netts and Mr. Landon, because at the time, we had the Department of Community Affairs. Does anyone know Department of Community Affairs? They were actually the agent in the state of Florida that regulated our growth management policies. Now, when Governor Scott took over, he made it very clear that he wanted to do away with this overburden red tape regulation, and he dismantled DCA. He put it underneath the Department of Economic Opportunity. As Mayor Canfield has explained, growth is absolutely that. It's economic opportunity in our community. So the good news is the governor recognized home rule. That's where we define our own future, our own destiny, what we're going to look like and what we're going to be in the future, and put it back to us for us to determine. Now, these developments of regional impact have already gone through an approval process. They have gone through different processes with permitting agencies, but they're sitting on a shelf because the economy sort of stopped. So what is that going to look like in the future? That's an interesting equation. I loved what Mayor Netts said, and I concur 100%. We can't just focus on future growth at the detriment of the current growth that we have in our community. So we're going to have to try to marry those two. We're going to have to try to find a way to be consistent throughout to make sure it doesn't change our integrity of what we set forth to begin with. But it also means we're going to have new infrastructure costs, right? An impact on our utility, there's no doubt about it. That's why when you hear the word impact fees and other communities that have made the determination to do a moratorium on impact fees, to do away with impact fees. I can tell you St. John's County made the decision very long time ago to never do away with their impact fees, and they continue to be the number one permitting agency in the state of Florida. That's why they made that determination, because future growth, they didn't want our current residents to be paying for. So future growth has to be paid for by someone. Future growth should be paid for by the future people that are living there. And that is something that we set out a course very long ago to understand and identify. So how lucky are we that our city was laid out not too long ago for so much that we continue to value today? Those who envisioned our original city in 1970s got it right. It was a vision based on not just land profits, but also amenities that will draw retirees, young families, businesses, and executives to locate here. Early civic leaders, including my father, Jim Holland, chose to preserve and build a future based on peace and beauty that was already here. This was part of the deliberate decision-making process and something we must hold close to our hearts and future today. So I see positive development in the future for Palm Coast. Our city continues to expand on our green spaces. How many people have got to enjoy our new park, Long's Landing? It's a great place to go out and kayak. It's a great place to go out and birdwatch. It was something, again, the city had the forthright to go out and preserve and protect that will always be here for us to continue to enjoy. I see expanded junior and senior programs in our recreation department. This community center will be redeveloped in the next couple years. That will offer recreational amenities for all ages to come to enjoy. It's going to be interesting to see a change, because this has been a mainstay for us who've been here for so long to see what it is. But I enjoy the moment that we progress and we do it in a responsible way. I see students developing skills for high-paying jobs with quality education in our Flagler County Schools and Daytona State College. We have a great relationship with our school district. Our Daytona State College campus just got over $8 million to expand on curriculum over there. That's going to suggest that we have a lot of growth. We have over 13,000 students in our school district. We are mentioned all the time because of our technology advancements within our school district in Tallahassee. That's important for us to continue to coordinate and offer those services for our students, for our young families that have relocated here. What are they going to do, and what are they going to want to do in the future? That's going to be very important. I see cultural arts opportunities as we continue to expand and cooperate and communicate with our Arts Foundation. They're now currently in the stages of building a stage out of Town Center. Has anyone been out there to see the future development of that? It's amazing. That's going to offer some recreation and art opportunities for our community. Picnic in the Pops is already scheduled for next year. They're already selling tickets for it in May, and I can tell you there's over 1,200 residents that attend that annually. That offers a great cultural experience for our residents, as well as the expansion of our Flagler County Auditorium, located at our school district. That's another key component to our community. And there's a real value there of services that we offer to our community. So the choices we make today and in the future really do matter. This involves together what we choose or not to do in our community. As your new mayor, I want to help nurture and preserve the best elements that have evolved and evolved over the past decades in Palm Coast. Our common vision, you heard a lot about vision today. Vision is really important. Will require continuous dialogue with all citizens and communication between city and county government. The first step will be on November 15th when I'm honored to be sworn in as your next mayor. I promise to continue to work every single day to earn your trust and manage your city wisely. So together we can make these right decisions. Together you've seen what we were, what we've become, and how we've actually gotten to where we are today. I'm very proud of our city, but it is going to take a lot of us together collaboratively to work. I look forward to the 50-year story of Palm Coast. I think it's going to be a one of pride and celebration when we look back collaboratively today and say, what actually did we contribute to make it a community we can all be proud of? So I'm looking forward to taking the next chapter. It's been a great honor to watch these two very, very fine, distinguished men over the years really make some wise decisions. And I can assure you, I continue with that vision moving forward. I didn't run on a ticket of change. I ran on a ticket of continuation. And I ran on a ticket of actually what we have here and what we have to enjoy and how special it is and unique it is, and I hope to be able to be part of protecting that and preserving that for years to come. So thank you for being here today. I really appreciate it.
Just two more things, please. Two pieces of literature that you received. One, how Palm Coast became a city, fills in the background for that. The second is just a very, very brief overview of the entire city. I hope that you will take those and see them and read them. If indeed you're not going to or so, bring them back and we'll recycle them. But they're yours and we hope you'll enjoy them. Now, what do you do when you have three mayors like you've just listened to? I know the society was considering getting each one of them a sports car, for instance. That's, you know, really, really had that in mind. But you know what historical societies are like, okay? They're cheap. They're always asking you for money rather than giving it away or so. That's just not our styles. So maybe we can use some words. All right? Would you just? We came up with these words, and they are the best mayors that any city could ever have, okay? The best mayors that any city could ever have. And those are just, there you go. And past, present, and future, and they're in a frame, as a matter of fact. Okay. Go ahead, please.
Thank you very much.
Elaine Studnicki, thank you so, so much. You just asked to get something done, and Elaine gets it done. All right,
Not done.
Oh,
okay. Just a couple words, okay? And I was asked to say these things. First of all, how lucky are we, right? Aren't we lucky? Not only because we live in a community that works, but the character of leadership and that consistency has been remarkable. I'm so happy to be part of it. And I look forward to the future, Melissa. And you talked about the county, Flagler County, and the city working together. You know, there are a lot of different organizations that do work together, and sometimes they work well, sometimes they don't. But the historical societies work really well together. And I want to remind you that in 2017, the Flagler County will be celebrating its 100th birthday. And they have events throughout the entire year. So please be aware of that. Please make sure that you note it on your calendars that on April 29th, is our main event over on 100, and dignitaries will be there. Our mayors, I'm sure, will be there as well. Lots of activities for the entire family. So thank you very much.
Thank you.
We're done now.
See if we can bring John. Get a picture. Sure.